Bismillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdul Salam, and this is part two about the talk of those children born to unmarried parents. And this is the second side of the, or the other side of the coin. The whole argument used by the Salafi hardcore school of thought is open to be flushed away because it pivots and gravitates around the fact that they reject the ownership of the man of his wedlockless child. So the fornicated man, the whole concept is built on the child doesn't belong to the man. But what does Allah says? What does the mighty Allah say about this issue? Did Allah qualify someone in his noble truthful Quran to be a wedlockless child? Did Allah call someone in his book child of a zina? Did Allah say when or when not a child is considered fatherless? Does Allah say that a child can be made by more than two people? One who puts the sperm in the woman, and the other one who is married to the woman, and the woman? And most importantly, does Allah agree with this hardcore type of understanding? Has the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam really said what's reported on his behalf as absolute words that came out from him? Do the laws created by the man of religion fit with the universality of Islam? Would a man that was sent as a mercy to mankind, to the entirety of humanity, till the day of judgment, deprive a man from his child and a child from his father just because the father's water was deposited in the mother outside of a marriage contract? Would a God of mercy who sends a messenger of mercy to a humanity that needs this divine mercy, would Allah allow an emotional torture between a father and his child? After all, isn't there something called repentance? They can say the child belongs to the married woman whose husband has been away for 20 years, but what if the child is a split image of the father he begotten him or her? What if the child instinctively called to his father and her father? What about repentance? Doesn't this extreme hardcore school of thought say that repentance wipes out the sin? What if then, if the father sincerely repented, will he and his child be punished yet? I can go on with so many questions, endless hypotheses, but let us see what Allah says in the Quran, that everyone on earth, they say we must return to the book of Allah and the Sunnah of Rasulullah. And I say, let us go back to the book of Allah, then the Sunnah of Rasulullah. Let's see what Allah says. Who, after all, is the one who creates humans? Why didn't Allah reject the sperm of a fornicator? A fornicator sleeps with a woman. Since his water is spoiled, rotten, void, is not good, why did Allah create out of him a human? If Allah created a human out of that void, rotten, bad, evil sperm, so how do I understand this equation? Again, why didn't Allah reject that sperm of the fornicator and not made a baby out of it? But as I said, let us see what Allah meant and means for humanity. Why have the text of the Quran been exiled from the mainstream issues? Why have the words and opinions of the humans and hadith collected over 200 years after the death of Rasulullah ﷺ became the masters and the Quran became the slave? First thing to ask is, can a child be made by three people? And by this I mean, can a child be made from a sperm of a man, egg of a woman, ownership and attribution to a second man, the husband of the woman? It's unbelievable what the scholars ask of us Muslims, and it's even far more unbelievable, and it's to a degree that Muslims have today frozen their minds. They don't think, and as I said before, if you want to be a Salafi, you have to freeze your mind to breeze your way into Jannah, which is completely unacceptable. How can Muslims accept that a human being can be made by three people? The fornicator who made the human, the mother of the baby, and her husband. And it's unbelievable. This is a very important question, because in this pep talk, we are going to figure out the real deal about this issue. But before going any further, it is well remembered that since the days of old, as soon as the divine message is left to the care of mankind, always, always ends up under their interpretation, and the message ends up being away from what Allah meant for us, including Islam, including how the men of religion have designed our Islam. In normal circumstances, heavenly religion should have been the source of harmony, simplicity, love, and order on earth. When Allah sent the last Prophet ﷺ with the updated version of Islam, the idea was that humanity shall bathe in the blissfulness of Islam, and at last find that Allah hasn't abandoned humans He so created. Islam, as we know it, was supposed to be a religion of no contradictions, either with its own laws or with the human intellect it came to address and reason with. In the Salafi world, intellect and logic do not exist, and even though they claim and pretend. Otherwise, how come a man who makes a baby and that child is not his because his sperm is void, and yet you have to accept that because a Nawawi said, as if a Nawawi was another messenger that we didn't know of. Allah beautified humans with the mind. The way we think and reason is beyond belief. Flesh, look at your mind. What is it made for? Just meat, water, nothing. There is no mechanics. There is no nothing. It's just flesh and meat. The mind is so powerful, so unbelievable, so creative, so unlimited, so curious, so demanding, so logical, so emotional, and so detective. This is why humans will abandon any religion or ideology that clash with its intellect. So many great people of science were killed by the men of religion because of their scientific discoveries, just because they thought these discoveries didn't agree with the holy books. The Torah and the Bible, even the Quran. Sadly, even though we claim that Islam encourages science and scientific researches, our scholars have written many a topic that totally resembles what the people of the book did. Absolutely nonsense. Logic has and is always used to prove a point. Any invention, any discovery, or any great step made by humans always starts with the thought that our mind juggles endless times till it sees clearer and sharper than our physical bodies, go on to turn that thought into something tangible that can use and touch. As I said, logic has and is always used to prove a point. For example, we use logic to challenge the beliefs of others, and even Allah uses logic in the Quran. So many logical debates took place between messengers and others. Even Allah used logic to drive his points home with those who don't believe in him. Otherwise, why would Allah say, I sent water from the heavens and it went on a dead earth and it revived the earth, and then you see the fruits coming out and you eat from these fruits? The logical question is, can't the one, and Allah asks that logical question, can't the one who has done that recreate the dead people? The logical answer is yes. So even Allah uses logic to drive a point and guide people to where he wants them to do. Another one, Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he looked at his people and he says, ma ta'budun, what do you worship? They say, na'budu asnaman fanadhallu laha akifin. They answered, we are worshipping idols and we remain to them very devoted. Ibrahim answered back, hal yasma'unakum idh tad'un aw yanfa'unakum aw yadurun? Can they hear you when you call upon them or benefit you or harm your foes? A special attention must be paid to the compelling logical arguments that Ibrahim challenged his people with. Since all humans agree to the fact that rocks can't talk, nor can rocks defend themselves or defend anyone for that matter. So, if that all we agree to this logic, so how come you worship a rock? The rock can do nothing for you. And this is the logical thing that Ibrahim was driving to them. And then, because they could not fight his logic, as mentioned in Al-Quran, they say, بَلْ وَجَدْنَا آبَاءَنَا كَذَلِكَ يَفْعَلُونَ. The only answer that they found to fight his logic was, however, we found our fathers and their forefathers doing this. And this is exactly the Salaf what they want from us. They want us to say, this is how we found our fathers and forefathers doing this, even if it goes against logic. And this, and you can read the whole argument in Surah Ash-Shu'ara, that is number 26, the poets, starting from Ayah 69. So Ibrahim's logic was that if you use rocks to build houses, shops, farms, and bridges, if you use rocks and you can sculpt them into a statue or a donkey or an animal or a staff or something. And you do whatever you do, how can you take them as your gods? Yet when they were cornered again, they went back to the weakest of the links, our parents. But when they froze their intellect and surrendered their minds to the past and enslaved their minds to the fathers, Allah rebuked them. In very few ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَبُرِّزَتِ الْجَحِيمُ لِلْغَاوِينَ, and hellfire will be brought forth to the deviators. وَقِيلَ لَهُمْ, and it was said to them, أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْبُدُونَ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ, where are those who used to worship besides Allah? هَلْ يَنْصُرُونَكُمْ أَوْ يَنْتَصِرُونَ, can they help you or help themselves? فَكُبْكِبُوا فِيهَا هُمْ وَالْغَاوُونَ, then the idols will be hurled headlong into hellfire along with the deviants. وَجُنُودُ إِبْلِيسَ أَجْمَعُونَ, and the entire army of Iblis, Shaitan, all together in hellfire. قَالُوا وَهُمْ فِيهَا يَخْتَصِمُونَ, there the deviant will fight with each other, will dispute with each other, will cry while disputing with their idols, saying, تَاللَّهِ إِن كُنَّا لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ, by Allah, we certainly were in clear deviance. إِذْ نُسَوِّيكُمْ بِرَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ, when we made you equal to the Lord of all the worlds. وَمَا أَضَلَّنَا إِلَّا الْمُجْرِمُونَ, and no one misguided us except the criminals, meaning none led us astray other than the wicked, speaking of their fathers and their forefathers. Subhanallah, in life their fathers and those that came before them paved the way for them to believe, but in the hereafter clever people became criminal and deviants. This is why Allah asked them a very logical question, مَالَكُمْ كَيْفَ تَحْكُمُونَ, what's wrong with you, how do you judge? Allah has made it very clear that the worst of creatures are ever on earth that Allah has ever created and moved on earth are those humans that do not use what Allah favored them with, their intellect, those who can't use the abilities for the reasoning. In the Salafi world today, they call you aqlani, intellect, use your intellect, and it's an insult, meaning you don't believe in Islam. Absolutely not. Allah has rebuked and has asked Muslims, don't just believe. When you read the Quran, when Allah gives you a logical example, I sent water and this happened, am I not gonna recreate you on the Day of Judgment? You answer, yes, Ya Allah, you can. Allah wants us to use our brains. Listen to this very threatening and scary statement in Surah Al-Anfal. And this is Surah number 8 in the Ayah 22. إِنَّ شَرَّ الدَّوَابِّ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ, indeed, the evilest and worst of all beings that move on earth in the sight of Allah are, pay attention, الصُمُّ الْبُكْمُ, the deaf who don't listen to the truth, and the mute who can't speak the truth. الَّذِينَ لَا يَعْقِلُونَ, those who don't use their intellect. Indeed, my dear brothers and my sister, reasoning and logics are a gift given by Allah to all humans, regardless of their color, religion, gender, or race. This is why logic works throughout time and all over the earth. And those who refuse to use their mind are as close to those deprived of their intellect and reasoning, and that is animals. So the logical reasoning used by Allah Himself when He gave different example, for example, yeah, ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا, Allah has struck a similitude. Allah gives you an example. What is that example, Ya Allah, or what are you driving in us? He says, رَجُلًا فِيهِ شُرَكَاءُ مُتَشَاكِسُونَ, a man whose ownership is shared by several quarrelsome masters. So we have one slave and he's got so many masters. And then Allah gives, وَرَجُلًا سَلَمًا لِرَجُلٍ, and another man who is exclusively owned by one man. هَلْ يَسْتَوِيَانِ مَثَلًا, can they, the two men, be alike? This is a very logical question. You've got one slave and you've got another slave. One slave has got so many masters, and these masters do not agree with each other. They quarrel, they disagree, they do everything. And another slave who is owned by one master, can they be equals? The answer, the logical answer is no. Then Allah says, بَلْ أَكْثَرُهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ, but most of them do not know. Why? Because a lot of them, they take so many masters, and if you took Allah one as your master, you will have the peace of mind of that slave who has just one master. The entire humanity throughout the ages until the end of time will unanimously agree on one answer, and that answer is no, they are not equal. So again, that is how logic is used by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But our problem is we don't pay attention to the Quran. Allah says, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ, don't they reflect on what's in the Quran? Allah is not talking to the kuffar. Allah is not talking to the world. Primarily, He's talking to you and me, the Muslims. Aren't we reflecting on what's in the Quran? وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ, and had it been from any other than Allah, they would have found in it so many contradictory statements. لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. Such is the guarantee, my dear sisters and my brothers, from Allah, that the Quran is free from any discrepancies, free from any divergences. Allah further describes His holy book, sublimely, as in Surah Fussilat, explained in details. And that is Surah 41, Ayah 41 and 42. Look what Allah says about the Quran. وَإِنَّهُ لَكِتَابٌ عَزِيزٌ, and it surely, Al-Quran, is a mighty and honorable book. لا يأتيه الباطل من بين يديه ولا من خلفه. Untruth or falsehood do not approach it nor touch it either from its front or its behind. تنزيل من حكيم حميد, a descended revelation from the wise worthy of all praises. And what Allah means by لا يأتيه الباطل من بين يديه ولا من خلفه, untruth or falsehood do not approach it nor touch it from either the back or the front, meaning when the Quran speaks about the past, it speaks the truth. No one is going to come up and says, oh, Al-Quran says this and this never existed. Whatever Al-Quran spoke about in the past is 100% guaranteed true. And ma bayna yadayhi, whatever is coming up in front of his hands, is whatever is going to come in the future about the day of judgment and all those things. So again, when the Quran speaks about them, it's 100% that they are true. So let us see what answers can we find in the holy book of Allah, the Quran, about once the wedlockless child is born, who does it get linked to? The two men and a man and woman fornicated, a child is born. What does the Quran say about that child? Two, whose name shall this child take? Three, why have the scholars and their followers till today issued different rulings? Four, has the Quran been consulted on this topic? Five, how should Muslims behave when logic contradicts the Quran and Hadith? Is there really a logic that contradicts or disagrees with the Quran? Is there really a logic that contradicts with Islam as a whole? But anyway, in other questions, we are going to face, as we go along in our study, what other scholars have said about this issue. So let's see about the universal logical truth first. Humans all around the earth, regardless of when they existed or when they will exist, agree on a universal logical truth, and that is, to make a child, we need one male, one female are required. Even the Quran fully and extensively agree on this universal logic. Even if a woman fornicates with six men, it only takes one water of one man to make one baby. That is still one man and one woman. Since this is so, how come a great number of scholars for the last 1400 years and until our days insist that this logic can go out of the window because of the Islamic evidences they gather from a hadith? Isn't that going to put the Quran in jeopardy? Isn't that going to make people start doubting the whole Islam altogether? How can we claim that Islam is good for humanity, regardless of where and when that humanity might be, then tell that humanity that even though science and genetic discoveries and laws have established beyond any shadow of doubt that a child is the produce of the unison between this man and this lady, then we tell them that to humanity that the child, because it is born out of wedlock, and I'm talking about Islamic wedlock, considered that Islam considers this child fatherless, no matter what. Even if they use DNA and they prove that the child belongs to this man, we tell them Islam says no, because Mr. Nawawi said that his water, the sperm of this man, is void. This child can't carry the name of this man or her father's name, nor can he or she inherit from the father, or the father inherit from him or her, and that the child can belong to the husband of the woman and carry his name of the absent man, husband, even if he has been away for 20 years. What kind of logic is this? This kind of conclusive logic would make the mighty book of Allah seem like an illogical book, an unauthentic book that pushes any understandings that science and humans have established beyond doubt forcefully onto humans. What I mean by that, DNA says his son. So everything points to that man being the father of this child, except that they are not Islamically married. I'm talking about Muslims. Suddenly we turn to the man and say, no, he is not your child. How come it is not his child, Ya Allah? And Allah has said in the Quran that he has created man and woman from two people, one man and one woman. How come our scholars have gone to the point where they reject the book of Allah? Subhanallah al-Haq. How can we invite the world to accept and follow Islam when we tell them that if a couple produces a child out of wedlock in our Islam, in our religion, in the religion of mercy, the child can't be attributed to the man, and the child belongs to a woman alone and takes her name, is financially responsible, the woman is financially responsible for that child, no matter what DNA says or the genomes say. How can we convince the world of this incredible so-called Islamic logic? How can we convince and educate the world that a married woman who made the mistake of sleeping with another man, that her husband who has been away for 20 years, that when the child is produced, it belongs to the man who has been away for 20 years? What kind of logic is this? What do we do with the Quran that says we created the man from a man and woman? What are we going to do with that? And then we wonder why the great majority of Muslims and the world aren't taking the Quran seriously? Yes, on paper and verbally, Muslims claim to follow the Quran, but practically the great majority don't, and with the supper, greater majority have no clue about what the Quran says in the first place. The hadith that all schools of thoughts pivot around is Al-waladu lil-firash wa lil-ahil al-hajar. The child is for the owner of the bed, as for the fornicated man, gets nothing but the rod. So let's see what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about this. And the hadith doesn't create man. The scholars do not create man. It is Allah who creates a human being. So a child is made out of water. Allah has countlessly emphasized that a child is the produce of a man and a woman, regardless of the relationship. Allah never ever mentions the relationship between a man and woman when he speaks about the birth of Al-Quran. Allah calls them Al-Walidain. Al-Walidain is different from Al-Abawain. Just like in English, the father and the dad, they are different. The child can have one father, but he can have so many dads. So the walidain are the begetters, those who gave birth to the child. Allah swore by this in Surah Al-Balad, Surah number 90, Ayah number 3. Allah says, "Wa walidin wa ma walad." So Allah says, "And I swear by the begetter and that which he begot." It also means, "And by the father and that which was born of him." Or, "And I swear by every parent and their child." In this ayah, Allah confirms that the child comes from the one that produces and provides the water, also known as sperm. One ayah would have been more than enough to establish that one who produces the sperm that is the one that owns the child, and that's that. Yet many men of religion will reject this ayah because of a hadith, and this is the calamity. Any ayah in the Quran that doesn't fit their wishes and what they want, they will tell you straight away, this ayah is abrogated. It doesn't serve anymore. It's like it's written in the book of Allah, and that's that. Application, zero. Recitation, with each letter you get 10 rewards. What kind of logic? My mind wanna really blow away. But here is another ayah that further reaffirms the universal logical truth that all mankind subscribe to, except Muslims. That the one who impregnates the woman is their father. Entirely on earth, everybody believes this. The Quran says this, yet we Muslims, we don't act on it. Look at this. Allah establishes this very fact, that the one who impregnates the woman is the begetter. And the begetter is the one who caused a child to come to existence. As mentioned in Surah Al-Waqi'ah, that is Surah number 56, and it's called, a translation, the inevitable, like the Day of Judgment, Ayah 58 and 59. Allah challenges the non-believers and he tells them, أَفَرَأَيْتُمْ مَا تُمْنُونَ. So have you then seen what you ejaculate? Tell me about the semen you drop in the wombs. This is like the meanings in English of the Arabic words. Then Allah says, أنتم تخلقونه أم نحن الخالقون؟ Do you create it yourselves or are we the creator? So as you can see here, Allah speaks about the producers of sperm and He's talking to non-believers. Allah tells them, have you seen the water that you drop in the women? Are you the one who make out of that water a human being or are we not? Allah here didn't say, you must be married, you must be this. Allah talks about who produces the sperm. That is the father of the child. This is why Allah further on says, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ إِحْسَانًا. And we commanded the human, both man and woman, to show goodness to their begetters. To their begetters. And this is unbelievable that in our logic, Muslims, if a man produces the sperm, the child doesn't belong to him. In what right do we say that? How can we put people into doubting Al-Quran? Allah then subhanahu wa ta'ala says, حَمَلَتُ أُمُّهُ كُرْهًا وَوَضَعَتْهُ كُرْهًا. His mother carried him, i.e. the human, with hardship and delivered him with hardship. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows one way. The way a human can do for the two people who begot him or her, which is to make dua for them on top of the different acts of goodness that he or she can show to the begetters. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Rabbi awzi'ni an ashkura ni'amataka allati an'amta alayya wa ala walidayya. My Lord, grant me the power and ability that I may be actively grateful for your favors which you bestowed upon me and upon my begetters. My brothers, pay attention. Allah mentioned al-insan wa wassayna al-insana. Al-insan is a human being. Allah didn't talk about the religion, didn't talk about the color, the nationality. A human being, and a human being could be somewhere in the depth of the Amazon jungle, or it could be at the skyscraper in New York City. Allah did not mention his belief. Allah mentioned a human being. This should have been enough to prove that the begetters are those who produce the child regardless of their relationship status. And this applies to the whole world, not just to Muslims. And here is another clear-cut compelling evidences. And inshallah, I will finish the talk pretty soon. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُم مِّن نَفْسٍ وَاحِدًا. It is He, i.e. Allah, the one who created you from one single soul, and that is our father Adam. The great majority of people on earth subscribe to this reality. وَجَعَلَ مِنْهَا زَوْجَهَا. And from it, from that single soul, made from it its double, its partner. And that is Allah created the woman. لِيَسْكُنَ إِلَيْهَا. So that he finds peacefulness with her. That the husband finds peacefulness, serenity with the woman. And this is something that women give to a man. فَلَمَّا تَغَشَّهَا. And when he covered up the woman with his body intimately, i.e. when they had sexual intercourse, i.e. the missionary position, where the woman is on her back and the man is on top of her. Okay? حَمَلَتْ حَمْلًا خَفِيفًا. She carried within her a light load of the sperm of the man. And then as that sperm develops and starts becoming weighty and the human starts forming, Allah says, فَلَمَّا أَثْقَلَتْ. Then when she became heavy with it, with that baby, دَعَوَ اللَّهَ رَبَّهُمَا. They supplicated to Allah, their Lord, saying, every human being, when the woman is impregnated, they all turn to Allah to make dua that the baby comes safe. In different religions, different rituals, different things, but the end is the same. A Buddhist will make dua to whoever they believe is Allah, who at the end is Allah, so that the baby comes, alhamdulillah, in all the best that the parents wish for them. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَإِنْ أَتَيْتَنَا صَالِحًا. If you grace us with a good child, لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الشَّاكِرِينَ. We shall certainly be of those who are actively thankful. And this is a logical thing that all humanity do. Jewish people, they beg Allah. Christian people, they beg Allah. Atheists, they do whatever they do. Buddhists, Indians, Hare Krishnans, all of these people, they turn to Allah for the best for their children. I do not wish to provide any further evidence from the Quran, as I said, because it's very obvious, universal reality that only scholars, our old and recent, do not accept nor understand Allah. Yani, I pray to Allah that Allah helps us. I don't know how our scholars today, they just give you this can make answers without going back to the Quran, and the Quran is absolutely clear about this. Allah helps us if this is how our scholars behave. Allah helps us. So now let us jump to the next issue of support and finance. Who finances the child that is born? Before saying anything about this point, let us hear what Allah says first. وَالْوَالِدَاتُ يُرْضِعْنَ أَوْلَادَهُنَّ حَوْلَيْنِ كَامِلَيْنِ. And the begetting mothers should breastfeed their begotten children 2 complete years. This breastfeeding, my sisters, is not compulsory, but is rather just an available option for those who want to take it. This is why Allah further added, لِمَنْ أَرَادَ أَن يُتِمَّ الرَّضَاعَ. For those who wish to complete the breastfeeding. So if you want to stop, no problems at all. Then Allah reveals who the father truly is. The way Allah sees it, and I don't care what An-Nawawi says, I don't care what that hadith says, I care what Allah says and how Allah sees it. Then the way Allah sees it is, the owner of the sperm who contributed to the begetting of the child is the father. And this is what Allah straight away refers to the man as, وَعَلَى الْمَوْلُودِ لَهُ رِزْقُهُنَّ وَكِسْوَتُهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. And it is for the man to whom the child is born to provision and clothe them, i.e. the mother and the child, according to what is known in the community they live in. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here speaks about the husband. He didn't speak about the religion, the belief, the iman, the relationship. He speaks about the man who has begotten the child. Then further later in the same ayah, Allah says, word by word, that the child belongs to the one who provided the water and to she who carried and delivered the child from her womb. Listen to this logical and universal truth. لَا تُضَرَّ وَالِدَةٌ بِوَلَدِهَا. A mother should not be made to suffer because of her child. وَلَا مَوْلُودٌ لَهُ بِوَلَدِهِ. Nor should he to whom the child is born made to suffer because of his child. What more could Allah tell us? What more could he emphasize that the child is the produce of the man who dropped the water in the mother, not the 20-year absent husband? This ayah clearly establishes who the father is and who must take care, support, provision, the cloth and the habitat for the child. It is the one who impregnated the woman legitimately or not. For the child naming, they said the child cannot be attributed to the father. Let us see what the Quran says. Allah says, وَمَا جَعَلَ أَدْعِيَاءَكُمْ أَبْنَاءَكُمْ. And he has not made your adopted sons your sons. Every time the scholars speak about this ayah, they always go back to the story of Zayd ibn Haritha, that Rasulullah ﷺ adopted and called him the son of Muhammad. Then Allah revealed this ayah and he told him, no, he is not your son, he is the son of his father. Every time they speak about this, they render this ayah in the past, and that is not true. This ayah is valid now, tomorrow, after tomorrow, as it was valid yesterday and 100 years before that, or 1,400 years before that. So Allah says to me and to you, وَمَا جَعَلَ أَدْعِيَاءَكُمْ أَبْنَاءَكُمْ. And he has not made your adopted sons your sons. Some people today, when they adopt a child, they give them their name and they call him my son. Everything is there. Then Allah tells them, Allah has not made your adopted sons your sons. That is nothing but what your mouth utters. ذَلِكَ قَوْلُكُمْ بِأَفْوَاهِكُمْ. But would Allah sugarcoat it when he speaks about this very touchy matter, so that not to have the child or his adopters? Certainly not. And this is why he further added, وَاللَّهُ يَقُولُ الْحَقِّ. And Allah speaks the truth. وَهُوَ يَهْدِي السَّبِيلِ. And he is the one to guide to the right and correct path. So that's that, my dear brothers and my sisters. Allah speaks the truth, but humans do not. So if you were to ask Allah about whose name shall a child of wedlockless couple, a couple that, where the parents are not married, who the child should be attributed to, whose name should he carry? The answer is, Allah has already set the record in his book straight. The Quran here, and it is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our Lord, our divinity, our Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands. ادعوهم لآبائهم هو أقسط عند الله. Name them, the children, call them after their fathers. Such is more just with Allah. when this instruction, as I said, is revealed, it always goes to the past. But as far as we are concerned, the Quran is the book for the living humans. And since we are alive now, then this instruction applies to us and will apply to any that comes after us. It is a law to follow. Therefore, any man who impregnates a woman is the biological father to the child, and the child is to carry the name of his father. And that is that. No spoiled sperm and certainly no bad water, because Allah makes out of it a human being. How can it be? Still, I don't understand the reasoning of Nawawi, and what's worse and more shocking, how the other scholars just follow it. In conclusion, a child is a child regardless of their color, religion, status, of the beggar's relationship, married, not married. As soon as that lump of flesh hits the floor, the only two parents he'll ever or she'll ever possess are the begetting male and the begetting female that produced the water and the air, and that's that. As such, depriving a child of their fatherhood and motherhood's right is far worse than taking their eyes off their heads, totally inhumane. Especially after Allah has engraved such truth, universal truth that all humans subscribe to since the ancient times, since man walked earth for the first time ever, that to make a child, one man is needed and one woman is needed. This is why when Allah addresses humanity, he talks to them about something they all well know, they all agree to, and they all can relate to. Listen to how Allah reasons with his creation. Ya ayyuhan nas, you people. What a beautiful call. A call to humanity, referring to them as people. No race, no color, no religion, no wealth, no status, and anything that comes to mind. The call is to the humans in them, to the human side in them. Inna khalaqnakum, we have made you. As such, Allah is the real doer. He is the one that morphs the drop of sperm of the male and the female, and out of both brings a child. Obviously, Allah needs no contribution from anyone to create a child. But he chose the way things are now so that we humans can fathom the child-making process and see the miracle of Allah. Because when Allah created a human without a father, earth population went to the extreme and called that child Son of God. So, who did Allah choose to make a child? Min dhakarin wa untha, from a male and a female. Such is the universal, acceptable, and tangible truth. One man, one woman make a child, and that child is the result of their physical union. Period. Full stop. That's it, and that's that. Notice how Allah didn't bring any, nor mention the type of relationship that the man and the woman should be having at the time of making the child. You see, when Allah reveals the Quran, he certainly knew that one day the whole world will turn, as it turns out now, fornicating, making baby out of this or that. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew all this, and even that, he still insisted that a human being, a child, is made from one man and from one woman. And don't you ever think that, oh, times were different back then. Because Allah, huwa alladhi la ilaha illa huwa alimul ghaybi wa shahada. He is Allah, whom there is no God worthy of worship except Him. He is the knower of the seen and the unseen. He is also the knower of the invisible and the visible, the knower of what exists, shall exist, and the knower of what exists now. Therefore, it is far more than obvious that Allah knew that humans will fornicate. He knew women will be tempted by shaitan, and they will commit mistakes, they will break Allah's laws, and they shall certainly become slaves to their sexual desires, and in the heat of the moment will make a child out of wedlock. This is, we Muslims are bound by marrying the way Islam instructs us, and as I said, we are not talking about other people, we're speaking about us. Yet Allah in His infinite wisdom commands the child to look after those who begot him, the two who brought him to life, to this world. And since all humans except Jesus, son of Mary, came the very same way, we owe it to ourselves to build bridges between us and get to know each other in good spirit and remain humble, because the true measurement tool is nothing else but justice, fairness, and humbleness. Allah has invited the humans to get acquainted with each other, seek that what unites them, build bridges, and build one big family. This is why he further says, وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلًا, and we made you into nations and the tribes. So Allah multiplied us into a great number of nations and tribes, and for the purpose of what? لِتَعَارَفُوا, to get acquainted with each other and know each other. And how would we, humanity, get to know each other when a great number of them are born out of wedlock? But Allah didn't differentiate between humans. To Allah, a human is a human. How he came on earth doesn't matter. I repeat, to Allah, a human being is a human being. How he came on earth doesn't matter. The parents are married or not married. They will carry the burden for their fornication, but the child is a full-blown, full-fledged, completely a human, totally, fully emotional, that he has everything. There is absolutely no difference between a child that is born to parents that are married or child that are not married, except the one thing, the error of the parents. Any than that, the child is 100% beautiful in the sight of Allah. I will end the talk here. This is part two again. It looks like I need a part three. And in part three, inshallah, I will speak about the Bible and how it looks at those children. And bismillah, I will also speak about the historical implication, the political implications that caused this kind of misunderstanding happen. And I pray to Allah to guide us all. Again, this is your brother, Abdul Salam Abu Hanifa. If you want to join my group, please do send me a message on 07876-408738, and you can also find this talk and many others on my YouTube channel on Islam Pep Talk. Wassallallahu nabiyyina Muhammadan, Allah knows more, and I will see you at part number three. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.